Welcome to a Magic TV Extra. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We got a question from Robert Neal in Tennessee. Robert wants to know, how do you make a good Manabase? What do you do to make it work?
So what I mostly do is after I finish my draft, I hit add lands on Magic Online.
Okay, go on.
I hit suggest.
Okay.
And then I hit done. And it gives you all the lands I need.
That's it?
But I think Robert's probably looking for a better answer to
okay,
that.
Okay, okay. I mean, we can talk about draft. We can also talk about constructed. I mean,
well, draft is the one that's going to be usually a lot harder because in constructed, if you build a deck, you can usually look online and see decks that aren't at least very similar to the same colors and get a good idea. Like if, let's say you want to make a black-red-green deck, not stock Jund because, you know, otherwise you'd have the mana base, you can still probably use a very similar mana base and it would be just about right. There's so many examples of mana bases online for constructed decks that it's not that usually hard to figure it out.
But now, one thing that immediately pops into mind is if you were to use a stock mana base, how many tap lands are in your deck? Like, what does your deck do? If you're going to play with a red or well, red, like, green, like, black control deck,
yeah, I mean, that's
play
that's
more tap lands?
No, John plays about as many as you'd want. They already play like 8 to 10, you know, tap lands. But let's look at a limited, I think. I think limited's a lot harder, and limited you have to do it by yourself on the fly. Like, you know, you've got 5 or 6 minutes.
I mean, I know I draft in real life with a timer all the time where I have to make sure that I put my lands in there in the right time, so.
Well, you're not supposed to be able to ask other people is the thing. So,
so what do we got?
There's a couple rules of thumb. First is like splashing. So when I splash, if I'm splashing one card, you can usually get away with like 2 mana sources, obviously for a single color card, because you don't splash double color cards except in really rare circumstances.
Mysteries of Deep in our right white-red deck.
Right, that's a good example. So you could probably get away with 2 islands. It's because you also aren't splashing early game cards. You're not going to splash step links. You know, it doesn't make any sense.
You're not putting a Hedron Crab into that deck.
No. Like, so it's a card that is good late, and 2 islands is enough. That's, you know, borderline, but, and you certainly can't go 1, but often you're not going to be able to afford 3.
Now, other examples to that end. Let's say I'm already playing an expedition map because I have a Quicksand and I have like a Smoldering Spire.
Right. If you're already playing an expedition map or a Harrow, you can get away with like 1 source.
Yeah. Again, you can double count those land searchers on top of how many sources you have for that.
Right. Like Verdant Catacombs if you're splashing Smother in a green white deck.
Okay.
So the next step is if you're splashing 2 cards, I generally like 3 sources of mana. And that I like 3 for 2 a lot better than I like 2 for 1, because you're by 50% increasing the amount of colored sources you have. And then once you get into like 3 cards, 4 cards, at that point you're splashing a little heavy and you kind of want to avoid it. But even splashing 3 cards, you could probably get away with 3 or maybe 4 sources.
And now we're not even talking about like trying to get as greedy as to playing a double colored card as a splash card.
I mean, double colored cards are not cards you want to splash except in like rare circumstances. Like if you had 2 Harrows, I could see splashing a Comet Storm, because not only is Comet Storm absurd, you have 2 Harrows that both get you to Comet Storm by themselves. So, but in a normal deck, you can't splash a double color card without good fixing.
So in rare circumstance, I've got two multi-colored fixers in like a Harrow. Because a Harrow could fix 2 colors
yeah, right.
of the mana. You could get away with playing a doubled colored card.
You could, I mean, and again, you'd only want to play the most powerful one. But so then past splashing, let's say if you're building a straight 2-color deck, in a 2-color deck, in like Zendikar, for example, where there are very few dual lands, I mean, there's a couple of the uncommon ones and a couple of man lands, but past that, and like fetch lands, but past that, most decks, you don't end up with any duels.
An important thing to note here is that the uncommon ones, and even the rare Worldwake ones, are only allied colors.
Yeah.
I mean, we had a conversation once where we talked about drafting white-black and the difficulty and the
yeah, white-black is one of the color combinations I like the least because they both have a lot of heavy colored spells. Like Core Aeronaut, you know, and Crypt Ripper, like Gatekeeper of Malakir.
And Kazandu Blade Master.
Right, it's like exactly.
You want to be able to play those spells at the right time, and it's really hard.
So when you're playing a 2-color deck, assuming you've got no dual lands, because you usually don't, I think the optimal setup is like 11-7. And you obviously have to draft a deck that can be 11-7. You don't want to have like, if you have an evenly split deck and you have to go 9-9, sometimes you have to do that. But it's best for your deck if you go 11-7. You've got a main color, and you play 11, and you've got a secondary color with 7. 10-8's pretty common. 12-6 is less common. Then at that point, you're talking about when you only have 5 or 6 cards of the secondary color. So the things to consider are what double color spells you have, when you need certain colors. Like, You may only have five white cards, but if two of them are step links, you probably can't get out of six planes because you're not playing step links early enough. Similarly, if your double color card is Comet Storm, you can still probably get away with seven mountains because you don't need it till you have seven or eight mana or six mana available.
No, I ran into almost that exact same situation recently where it's just like, I ended up with a bad aggressive deck because I was mostly green. Uh-huh. It had like double step links, core Arena. Like most of the cards you named were, I was like, well, I'm just going to change this up. Like, I mean, I can't really play a lot of these white cards and still have an effectively aggressive
deck. So there you either need to decide whether you want to cut the, you know, color intensive white cards and just play more forest, less plains, or just play like, you know, eight plains, 10 forests, even though you only have five white cards. And that's not a great solution either, which is why you want to draft the deck that wants an 11-7 mana base. Like, you want to try to stay away from double color in your secondary color, if you can.
I mean, it's funny that you just mentioned, like, the 10-8, the 11-7, the 12-6. It's like, I can't remember the last time I drafted a deck where I was like, I need 12 forests and 6 swamps. Like,
yeah, those that's much less likely than the other two. Most of my mana bases end up 10-8 or 11-7 and some 9-9s, which, you know, again, happens. And then, so once you get to, like, other formats, it gets a little more complicated, like Shards of Alara,
again,
for example.
Again, to have this conversation in Shards of Alara is, like, in a draft format where there's so much fixing given to you, where there's so many border posts.
Shards
obelisks.
Is a lot more complicated, and honestly, knowing how to build a mana base was one of the reasons I did well in Shards. It's because, you know, I like playing multicolored decks, even in formats where you aren't really supposed to, like in Champions block and stuff like that. So I'm used to, like, you know, stretching my mana base. So for Shards, again, you want it to be in three colors. You want it to be in a shard, usually, but you want it to be like two and a splash. So when you were Jund, you didn't want to be red, black, green, all caps. You wanted to be like red RB caps with a small G, or, you know, RG caps with a small B. Usually not black, green with a small red. That doesn't usually work. The off color doesn't usually work. And so let's say if you had no fixing, it'd be like you're aiming for like a mana base that would want 7-7-4. But then, of course, with all the fixing, that usually would bring it up to something like, ideally, like 9-9-6, while only still playing 18 lands or 17 lands. And the way you do that is panoramas, savage lands, border posts.
Valley Runner.
Like. Yeah, cyclers. So Shards is a lot more complicated, and since it's soon going to be rotating out a second time once, you know, Rise comes out, I don't want to get too deep into it, but...
I mean, but it's a conversation that's important. I mean, we've had Invasion Block, we've had Ravnica Block.
Yeah, like. I mean, the fixing there is very important. And again, the rule of thumb is you want it to be like in Shards, base 7-7-4, ideally with a couple more sources of each. The 6-6-6 is the mana base that shouldn't win. Like, that's the mana base that your opponent, you know, casts turn 3 Woolly Thoctron one of the games and you lose. Then the other two games can't cast until turn 6. Because 6-6-6 isn't a reliable mana base.
Well, they call it the Devil's Mana Base for exactly. That exact reason.
So, mana bases are tough. And in Zendikar, they're a lot easier than they have been in the super multicolor blocks. But they're still definitely worth paying attention to.
I mean, you had great success drafting monocolor decks at the Pro Tour.
Yeah, but at both the decks I drafted at the Pro Tour, I drafted monocolor, played 17 swamps, 17 forests, and then my green deck also had a Colony Garden, but so 18 forests, 17 swamps. You can't get color screwed if you're drafting monocolor, and I really like monocolor, but you can't go into it every time. I was kind of fortunate that I was sitting in seats that let me get into it, even though I did kind of force monocolor.
I mean, obviously your draft strategy has to change depending on how. I mean, like, obviously the thoughts of you building your mana base for your deck as you were drafting, what was important was, there was like, especially early, you're like, I'm going to take this card to commit to this one color.
Well, so like what happened in the first draft was I took Marsh Casualties over nothing, then I took Gatekeeper Malakir over nothing, then I took, and this is the most important pick in the draft, Vampire Lacerator over Shepherd of the Lost. But as I said before, I hate black-white. I already had a triple and a double color black spell. At that point, I would rather try to stay mono black if possible, and luckily it was possible. No one to my right was drafting black for like 5 seats. So, you know, sometimes you pay off, and when you run good like that, sometimes you do well at events.
Not worth talking about, Mario.
Right. So, moving back onto Constructed for a little bit, the lands that we have access to now in Standard are the tri-lands, which are good if you're playing all three colors, like Arcane Sanctum. The new man lands, which are good if you're playing two of the colors, you know, Raging Ravine. You've got M10 dual lands, which if you've got enough basics are fine, like Rootbound Crag. You've got Terramorphic Expanse, which some decks use. You've got Zendikar Fetches, you've got Border Posts. There's a lot of options right now. You've even got random, like, you know, Sedgerary Refuge and stuff like that, even though those are probably not as good as the man lands. So,
Ancient Ziggurat, Rupture Spire, also for those five color lands.
So, like, basically, if you're playing three colors, your options are to play tri-lands if you're a shard, or fetch lands if you're not, or eight fetches if you're not. So you've got a lot of options, but again, for Constructed, I'd say look at like decks that are similar to the deck you want to play and see what your options are there. Because people put a lot of work into those mana bases for like blue-white-red or Jund or blue-white. And so by copying them and then maybe adjusting them a little, you'll get a pretty good idea.
Mm-hmm.
So
sounds good.
Hopefully that helps with the mana bases. And yeah, it's a tough subject, but yeah. Hopefully that gives you a little bit of insight.
Good question, again. Thank you for submitting the... I already forgot the guy's name.
Robert.
Robert in Tennessee. I do remember where you're from, Robert. Again, if you have more questions for us at Magic TV, make sure you send them to magictv@channelfireball.com. Robert will be seeing that $25 in store credit momentarily. Keep those questions coming.
Thanks for watching.